So one Sunday afternoon, I had gone home. It was just a normal Sunday. I left early to go do my own thing while my brother set the rocks in at church because we had some sort of meeting that all the elders in the church had to attend. And, you know, there was going to be a little banquet, and they were all setting up for that. Well, I was on my way to church as Seth and Brock were on their way home. On my way to church, I passed an accident with some friends of mine, and we were just, you know, praying for these people, like these poor people. They totaled their car into a tree. Like, I heard people yelling, "Do not let that boy off the ground. Keep him down." Little did I know, though, those were my brothers in the car. I had no idea it was them. Didn't even cross my mind that it was my car that got totaled. We don't know how or why there was an accident. There were no brake, like tire marks on the road that showed that, you know, they were trying not to go off the road. They didn't see it coming. It was just, they went off the road into a tree. The first person on the scene called 911. The second person on the scene was a critical care nurse. She asked if they had helped them. They said no. Thankfully, she was the second person on the scene. She didn't call an ambulance. She was able to call the med flight. She said there was not time for an ambulance to come. Brock, his eyes were fixed, and he was unresponsive. That's like almost being dead. Like, he wasn't there. Seth, his airways were blocked, and he was thrashing. They said they had to have several people in the car holding him down, you know, keep his neck straight. The nurse was able to do CPR on Brock, which was, like, if that nurse wouldn't have been on the scene to get Brock, he probably wouldn't be there, because his brain injuries were so severe, he had no oxygen going to his brain. The longer he sat there without oxygen going to his brain, the more severe the brain damage would be. So thankfully, someone who knew CPR was able to be there. When I was at church, I was just sitting there. I was about to be babysitting all these little kids, and all of a sudden, I hear my mom scream. And if you know my mom, she's not like that. Like, she's very quiet. Like, not quiet, but, like, she doesn't go out of her way to, like, do much. Well, she screamed. A policeman showed up and talked to my stepdad and said, "One of your boys have been in an accident." I never thought it was Seth and Brock. It didn't. I thought it was my older brother Jordan. He was the more reckless one. Like, never even thought it was my brother still. On the way, my parents got into the police car, and on their way there, the dispatch came in and said, "The oldest one is on life support, and the youngest one is still unresponsive. Expect the worst when you get to the hospital." My brothers were not supposed to be alive. When we got to the hospital, we found out Seth had a bruised brain and a level 4 laceration on his liver, which was going to need surgery. Brock had severe brain damage, and he broke his femur. For the first few days, there was no news. It was just constant fear, because we didn't know what to expect. Within a few days, Seth's bleeding was controlled, and he no longer needed surgery, which, like, from the beginning when we found out he had the liver laceration, he was going to need surgery within days, like within less than days. But with God, he didn't need the surgery. Wow. Brock, with his brain damage, his brain was swelling terribly. He had a bolt screwed into his head to measure the pressure on his brain. They wanted to keep the numbers at around 19. Well, his numbers were spiking between 30 and 50. At that point, the neurologist told my mom, "We need to get him in for brain surgery." Most people in Brock's case, they would get a portion of their skull removed, not a large portion, like a portion, like one side. Brock's swelling was so bad he had to have the entire frontal flap removed, which I didn't even realize that was a regular until yesterday. But he needed that removed. Within a few days, the swelling started to go down. Not perfect by any means, like it was still incredibly scary. But it started to come down, and within a few weeks, they were going to start bringing Brock out of his induced coma. They hadn't done an MRI at this time, so we had no idea what to expect. We didn't know what Brock was going to be capable of doing until he did it. Once they were bringing him out of the induced coma, they, you know, were slowly bringing his oxygen down, trying to figure out what he could do. Which wasn't much at all, but once they did an MRI, they realized, thankfully, that the brain damage to his frontal lobe, which controls his personality, his, I think they said his ability to comprehend small things. That's all right in the frontal lobe. It was bad, but not as severe as they were expecting. Well, then they found the laceration in his brainstem. They had no idea that was there. They were shocked when they found it. And it was on the right side of his brainstem to where they immediately thought, okay, he won't be able to move the left side of his body ever again. Like, he just won't. He'll have to learn to deal with things with his right side. And they weren't sure exactly what parts were in the brainstem that were also severed. They weren't sure if he would ever be able to breathe on his own, ever be able to feed himself. Like, it was just unknown. And that was the scariest part of all, just not knowing what was going to happen. After the MRI, they told us within a week they were going to do a tracheotomy. And then a week after that, they would do an incision feeding tube into his stomach. After a few days, his breathing did start to improve. So they were hoping, okay, maybe no tracheotomy, which was great. Like, that was wonderful. But it wasn't enough to give us complete reassurance. So it came to the point where he's in the ICU, and the ICU people, they wanted him there. But then the rehab people, they wanted him there because they're thinking, if we don't start a rehab now, we don't know what's going to happen. So we kept him in the ICU a little longer for a few more days, and we started to see movements, like with his right side, like little things, like he wasn't fully conscious, so we would see him move his arm, he would move his leg a little bit, but we didn't really see anything on the left side. Well, then within a few more days, we saw his left side move a little bit. Nothing like major. Like, we weren't sure if he'd still be able to hold a pencil, but, you know, we thought he'd be able to move his arm a little bit, not be able to grasp anything, but, you know, he could move his arm, which was a really good sign. Well, when they moved him out of the ICU, they were doing their little examinations, and first thing they said within an hour was, he's blind. We freaked out. We prayed, and the next day, my stepdad walked in really quietly and walked to the edge of his bed, just kind of waved at Brock, and Brock waved back. My mom went to the nurse and said, he just waved. Can we get, like, an eye exam? And the nurse goes, you prayed. Why do you need an eye exam? So, you need to get an eye exam. Brock was not blind. Once we got to this point, things started happening very quickly. Like, I would see Brock one day, and he would be, like, unconscious, you know, just barely alive. And then the next day, I go in, and he's kind of awake. Like, okay, that's cool. And then I'd go in the next day, and he's mumbling, trying to talk, like, trying to say things, and that was awesome. Well, then, I wasn't there for a few days because I had started to go back to school, and I get a call from my dad, and it was Brock going, hey, we got food, don't pick anything up. And it was just like, I was not expecting that, like, it was miraculous.
Yeah.
So within this took time over weeks, but once he got into rehab, things just started happening so fast, and within a week, he was talking, like, looking at people, having conversations, and they started doing, like, small exercises with him, he was being able to do more, and, like, he was just improving, like, really fast, and it was amazing, and they decided that, you know, he was able to go home, he would continue to progress, and so we brought him home, he's wearing a helmet, and he's walking now, and they said the only reason he's limping is because it's in his head. He's babying his leg, and he should be able to walk fine, but it's just in his head. So Brock went from a little boy who would have to have constant care. Someone would have to feed him. He was going to have the tracheotomy, and he wasn't going to be able to walk. He may not be able to talk. We would never know what he'd be able to do. To where now, he's at home. He's probably playing Xbox right now. He is exactly the way he was before the accident. Like, there is nothing different except for the fact that he doesn't have a skull. But he's getting that back on in April. So he'll be good. But he's doing great. And I don't believe for one second that the doctors misdiagnosed him. I believe at one point he probably was blind and he was probably not able to move the left side of his body. But I think every time we pray, God healed him. I don't think the doctors are wrong. I just think Brock was constantly being healed.
Yeah.
And I don't doubt for one second in my mind that Brock can't do anything and be exactly how he was before. Seth is back at school now and he's doing great too. And they're both wonderful. And God has done so much for my family. And it's amazing.
Amen.
Okay, so now we are going to show you a PowerPoint of their family.